She was born and raised in Finland, where she also earned her first master's degree in education. She is currently the Interim Dean of Global Education at Minnesota State University, Mankato, where she also serves as the Senior International Officer and is responsible for the strategy and implementation of the university's globalization efforts. She has 25 years of experience from 7 different higher education institutions internationally and within the United States. She is a research award winner, a teacher, and a Fulbright scholar. She's worked with universities in the US and in Finland to assist in strategic planning and capacity building in multicultural education. She is also fluent in 4 languages and is an immigrant in the United States since 22 years. Dear listeners, I would like to welcome Dr. Anne Dalhman.
Hi, Dean Dalhman. Thank you so much for joining us in this episode of Future Proof with AIESEC Podcast.
Thank you, Mohamed. I'm thrilled to be here.
Yeah, me too. So let's get right into it. I understand you work in the education sector in Minnesota State University, Mankato, and I wanted to get a firsthand experience or story from your side within the global context with the pandemic and all of that happening. What changed within your scope of work and what did your world look like before and currently amidst the pandemic?
Right. Well, I've been in higher education for 25 years, and both as a teacher and administrator. And right now I work with staff and we support our incoming international students from 95 countries on campus, as well as American students going abroad, 300 students per year. And the change was absolutely dramatic end of February. Once the pandemic hit, we received a mandate from our state system to bring home everyone who was studying abroad. So we had students in dozens of countries. We had to bring them home. Everyone was trying to get flights. And we had some close calls, but everything worked out just fine. And then it moved very quickly into a crisis for our international students in Minnesota once the pandemic came into the United States. So we actually had over 1,200 international students, many of whom were physically stuck in Mankato. So they could not get flights or borders were closed. They literally could not leave Mankato to get back to their home countries, or it wasn't at that point as safe to go to their home countries. So the reality changed from a let's grow international opportunities, let's dream big, let's look at what's possible, let's look into the future, change into crisis management. Their needs were great by our international students who lost their employment once we went on remote mode on campus. International students who relied on on-campus jobs lost their jobs. So we had a lot of innovative thinking going into how do we support our international students. And I was very proud because the campus came together and created all kinds of opportunities. So that's what it looked like.
Okay. Yeah, it must have been really hard, especially for you, being one of the main responsibles for so many international students in a university. From what you've seen, what challenges do you see students currently facing during the pandemic being back to class right now?
Mm-hmm. There are a lot of challenges. First, we thought that the pandemic would last a couple months and we can do anything for a couple months, but it has turned out to be a longer term condition and situation. So people are so tired of the pandemic and the remote learning and as everyone else. But our international students, again, they are very worried about their health since they're far away from home. Everyone has health insurance, of course, but they're worried about their family back home. They're isolated, more isolated than our American students because they don't have family, and we discourage people from congregating and socializing because of the pandemic. So academically, our international students are amazing. And they don't complain as much about the online. They just want to be safe. And so that's our priority. So it looks a little bit, the challenges look different for our domestic students than our international students.
And what about in terms of being back to class? Are physical classes back in order, or are students doing it remotely as well?
Yeah, we opted for a flexible approach where we utilize asynchronous online, all online, synchronous online, where there are sometimes that they meet at the same time online, and then what we call flex sync, which is a hybrid method where student has the choice of coming to class physically or attending the class via Zoom. And the students who attend class face-to-face, of course, have to abide by all rules for safety, masks and social distancing. And we have also decreased capacity for seats in the classrooms. And so far, it's worked out. And students, they have liked a choice to be able to, like, for example, with the labs, they've been very happy that they can come to class if they choose to. And sometimes they have rotations of students. Sometimes more students want to attend via Zoom. And so people who want to attend in person can do so. And that has enabled us to be very flexible in terms of if a situation should change drastically, then we can put everything into a remote mode. And that's kind of the theme right now, that it's okay and students are learning and we are providing students with education. And we are doing a lot of surveying of students, working with the student government to get feedback all the time to make sure that we are improving and making sure that students get the best possible education under very, very challenging circumstances.
Yeah, I can imagine it's a big change for both the university and students. And it's good to hear that you're getting good feedback from students saying that they're enjoying the online learning, the opportunity to be at home and still join class. I'm wondering, though, anything that you've heard from freshman students, particularly, who have been probably looking forward to joining university for the last few years of their high school degree, but suddenly their college experience looks so different. What did you experience from your side regarding that specifically?
Yeah, so last spring, once we were communicating with our incoming class, first year students, it was very clear with our international students that they wanted to come to campus, like exactly what you said, that they had worked super hard for their dream to study abroad in the United States, MSU Mankato, and we worked super hard to try to see what's possible. And with the support of our administration on campus, we were able to offer a couple of options. We were one of the only campuses actually who brought in an incoming class, international students, physically into Minnesota and Minnesota State University. We had 30 students, brand new international students who were able to come, get a visa, get into the country, and join us at Mankato. However, we also have, as other options, we were able to offer students either deferral so that they were accepted and we would honor their admission for this spring or even next fall. And the third option was to study from home, either hybrid or online. And we have actually students right now studying in 35 countries from home. And that's pretty amazing. Both current students and new incoming freshmen also studying from their home countries. And so the idea is that start your studies at home and right when it's either safe for them or they are able to get a visa and get a flight, they plan to join us on campus. So we're just trying to stay very flexible, because we don't know the situation, how it develops, but we are we have lots of immigration advisors in our unit, and we are communicating with our students all the time and supporting them in their decision making.
It's really nice to hear that the university has been so committed to ensuring diversity and ensuring bringing more international students and not allowing this pandemic to get in the way. As you mentioned, you're one of the only universities who managed to get the 30 students. So it's really good to see that there are still people so committed to bringing and making universities more globally diverse. You've already spoken so much about the innovations or the very solution-centered approach that the university has been having towards this pandemic and towards this crisis. What is the one skill that came in handy for you as a professional and possibly for other professionals around you? What is that one skill that came in handy during this challenging time?
In my team retreat, I have a team of 22 staff on campus in global education. The theme for the retreat was creative resilience. And that really, I think, has distinguished us from some others who were more negatively affected by thinking that we can't do international education anymore in a pandemic. We feel that it's right now even more critical to find a way to engage because we are sharing an experience as the globe. And so we are committed to creative resilience, which is the capacity, and this is from Jay Davis from Psychology Today, the capacity to generate and act on positive solutions under the pressures of challenge and change. So as the unit leader, I really have stayed emotionally resilient. So when I hear my staff members or students, they have concerns, they worry, they feel like they can't do something, I will say, of course, we will get through this. Of course we can. We have no choice. We have 1,200 students on campus who are stuck and they need us. So people who are privileged, they can get defeatist and say, oh, we can't, it's hard. And so my approach always has been, we have the privilege and we have to stay strong for those who don't have an option. So I try to model being very calm, being very creative, and focusing on little steps, but always moving forward. So that allowed my team members to actually start moving and coming up with ideas. I say, any hard tasks, let me do it. Any hard conversations with parents or students, pass them on to me. So I would field all the, or many of the hard situations, or where we needed money, or where we needed quick, big decisions, I say, let me handle those. You keep coming up ideas for how we can support students, what do they need, reach out. And so I think that enabled us to be very, very nimble.
That's really insightful to hear many recurring themes, actually. For example, during my time as an AIESEC member, given that AIESEC is an organization that focuses on leadership development, we also are big proponents of privilege implies responsibility. And the fact that you have privilege, you should also use that privilege to ensure others who might not have the same privilege also have access to opportunities, to develop opportunities, to grow as people. So it's really nice that you led a team of 22 people towards that kind of mindset shift. And as you mentioned, capacity of creating solutions under pressure. I think that's really when a leader truly shines, right? Because it's when it comes to a crisis, that's when a leader truly shows their own abilities and they understand it themselves and also exhibits it towards their team.
I agree. And I think it goes even a little bit deeper than that. I think that institutions or leaders who have faltered have not gone into international education maybe in alignment with their mission or with their authentic purpose. For us, international education is a critical part of what we do. So it's a non-negotiable. When it gets hard, we don't stop. Or when it's easy, we don't just get more enrollments. We are committed to creating a global community. And so we are here to serve students and the community when it's easy, but especially when it's hard.
Yeah, as you mentioned, it's the little steps. It's always making things move forward, no matter how small the steps are. It's all about progress. That's really inspiring to see how committed you and your team are towards global diversity. Because as you mentioned, at the end of the day, we are going through this globally as a global community together. It's more essential now than ever. So right now, we know that the classroom environment changed for students, especially for freshman students. Their whole college experience changed. What are those skills that young people would need to thrive and to be able to compete in a job market in a post-pandemic world, given that so many students we hear lost their internship opportunities, many people lost their jobs as well. So how can young people stay competitive and employable?
Yeah, that's a very, very good question. And a lot of young professionals right now struggle with either getting internships or getting the optional practical training opportunities for international students or jobs. I think that those who have been more successful have really exhibited lots of entrepreneurial spirit. They create experiences and opportunities when others wait for them to happen. There are some people who apply for positions that are open and hope to get those positions. And if they don't, they feel discouraged. And then there are others who also apply for positions. At the same time, they volunteer, they come up with ideas and turn them into projects. They create experiences, products on their own to practice. And then those informal, unofficial projects and experiences will give them the leg up to actually get a position. So anyone who does not have a formal work experience needs to create skills and be creative about opportunities that they can literally create themselves. Whether it's if you're a software developer, ask a professor, can I help with a database project? I just had a couple of weeks ago a student, a computer information system student, undergraduate, contact me. Someone had said, ask Dean Dalhman. And I always try to provide opportunities if someone reaches out. And he says, I need practice with creating a database. Is there anything that you can do to help me? And so I have connected with some people on campus, and he'll be helping us to create a database of all the international partnerships that we have, a searchable database, and he'll be compensated through a project. And that he showed initiative and he showed skills. He had done a lot of things on his own. That was possible. And so I would just everyone to believe in their capabilities and show their value and their worth and just never give up. If you are the outsider, someone who does not have the connections right away, I remember coming into this country and everyone in the community had uncles and parents who already had the network. I would just literally call schools and say, can I volunteer and teach languages? Can I do this? Can I do that? And those turned into experiences that I was able to leverage when I was looking for positions.
Yeah, that's definitely really important to be proactive and create your own experiences. I think especially during this time, there might not be as many recruiters or headhunters maybe looking for talent. I think young people have to focus on gaining those practical experiences, as you mentioned, and to be able to show skills during the interview process and during the entire recruitment process. So how do you think young people in general can remain positive about the future in the current atmosphere?
I think what you have said about the privilege, those who have privilege, have assets, have resources, they need to also bear the responsibility of supporting those who have it even harder. There are people who are harder hit with the pandemic, with the financial downturn, with health conditions. So I would encourage those who are struggling but are not critically affected to be there for those who are even worse off.
So, Dean Dalhman, what do you think the future of education is going to look like in a post-pandemic world? What do you believe the change should center around?
Yeah, I do think that it's going to be different for a long time. I think that the notion of remote learning will be there for years to come, if not 10 years, where part of what we do is offered virtually. Not everything, once we get back to face-to-face instruction, I think there'll be just more options for programs and for students to attain their education through from their home countries, on campus, part-time, full-time. And some of these options are not available to international students, but there will be different kinds of modes for sure. At the same time, I think that people have been deeply affected by fear and uncertainty. So I think that our education, especially international education, will also be colored by people's need for safety and stability. Academics will be, of course, very important, but also people will need to feel safe and respected and appreciated at the same time.
Yeah, I think that's a very human approach and very empathetic approach around education. We don't usually talk about that, I think. We don't talk enough, at least, about what do people and students need right now. And yeah, it is stability and security in this very, very uncertain global atmosphere. All right, so Dean Dalhman, I will tell you a sentence and I'm going to ask you to finish that sentence, okay, for our listeners.
Sounds good.
For any young person listening, I want to tell them that
there's nothing more important in life than finding your authentic self. Always be you.
Beautiful. I agree 100%. The next one, for any person trying to find more clarity in times of personal and or global crisis, I would tell them,
you can do hard things. There's value in a struggle. Struggle is not failure, but it allows you to grow. So stay strong.
Yes, yes. And if all of the education leaders were listening to this episode right now, I would tell them,
listen to Mohamed when he says, recognize your privilege and reach out to young leaders who will be the future and mentor them. And don't tell them what to do, but give them a space to reflect and grow.
Yes, thank you for that. for sure, I definitely can second that from experience. When one last part that you can share with our listeners, what have you personally added to your routine in terms of self-care? What can you recommend to the audience? What tips do you have?
I have not added, but just been more purposeful of setting boundaries. I work super hard. I get a lot of stuff done, but I end my day every day at 4:30 p.m. After that, I hang out with my family. I have my husband of 24 years and our cats and dogs and chickens and live another life in the evening and exercise every day. But you have to draw boundaries.
Yeah.
Have a life, and that way you'll work better and with more purpose when you are working.
That's amazing. That's beautiful. Dean Dalhman, thank you so much for joining us on this episode and for sharing all of the insights that you bring to us in, today.
You are so welcome, and keep leading, Mohamed. You are a true future leader, and a lot of responsibility and possibility rests on your shoulders. And people at AIESEC, you all are a wonderful bunch of people.
Thank you so much, Dean Dalhman. I appreciate all your support.
You're so welcome.